Praise the Lord. Welcome. Celebration City is live. We are so blessed to know that you are watching us from all over the world. Some of you probably watched the morning service. This is the afternoon service here in Portland, Oregon. But it's the same flow, is the same spirit, is the same Lord that is in charge with our lives. So we bless the Lord for everything He does. We bless Him for your lives. What is He doing in there? And don't forget it, it says, in all circumstances, give thanks to the Lord, not for circumstances, but for overcoming the circumstances. Do this by the power of the Holy Spirit. I was, this week, I was talking to someone, a friend of mine and a colleague of mine from the place I work in. That was like a long time prayer, probably since we moved to Oregon, 20 some years. And I was praying and I was asking the Lord, is this, how many more people are there? You know, the Lord always said, there are another 7,000 for sure. You just don't know them. But they love me. They are after me. They are listening to the sound of the trumpet. They can hear when I call. And I said, sure, Lord, but, you know, the big churches, the all kind of, you know, nationality churches and the fights and the splits and the religious problems. So I made this friend, and we start talking, and you know when you start talking to someone and, you know, you start and he finishes, he starts, you finish, it's like, oh man, it's not just the brother, this is absolutely in the same thing that we are doing. And he starts telling me about ministry of intercession that the Lord is bringing to him for like, I don't know, 20, 30 years. He lives in Northwest. He connects with people that believe the same in Northwest. And their vision is prepare for the end time revival. So it's like, I heard end time. It's like, you really? It's like, yeah, this is it. This is it. So I said, well, we call it end time generation, but that's okay. We speak the same language. And I explained to him what I believe and kind of start tearing in his eyes. It's like, yes. It's like, praise the Lord. And you are, can you tell me again, you are in Oregon, in Northwest, and you believe this. That was like, wow. So lots of seeds out there. Lots of connections and networking. So prepare for that. Some of you that are listening are from Northwest, so I want to tell you too, prepare for the networking of the Holy Spirit, where He brings all that have the vision, have the direction, into one mind and one accord, because the time is short. Amen? So I just want to share that. I was really blessed by the Lord to do that. So, of course, we started regular meetings now, and we'll go places and do things together so we can see what the Holy Spirit has to do. It's bringing the people from underground into the visible place. He did something like that with us in the last couple of years. We were so much underground and nobody could find us, right? Travel around, nobody could hear, nobody could understand. It's like, oh, okay, this guy, oh, sonship, okay, that's all they know. Yeah, nobody could even see the vision of what the Lord is doing. So last couple of years, He brought us into the fruit and into the harvest. And this is happening with so many other people. So we'll see lots of them coming through. Amen. Excited of knowing the Lord is in this place, not because it's a special building, but who can tell me? How do I know the Lord is in this place? We are here. Yeah, bless the Lord in my brother, bless the Lord in my sister. I haven't seen her for more than a month. I see the Lord coming right here and enjoying each other in Him. Okay, so we're going to worship together. Let's stand up and bless the Lord. Amen.
Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent Father of mercy.
Oh, thank you, Father. Just open up right now. Whatever you are, He is right there. He's not far. He lives inside your body. He lives inside His body. In this place. Holy Spirit, you are the Spirit of the body of Christ. The Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit, one with the Father, one with the Son, He's right here in our midst. Praise you, Father. Open up your soul, open up your body. Open up. The Holy Spirit is ready to take over. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, you take over. This is your meeting. This is what you want to do. How you want to touch and heal and change, transform. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Praise you. Praise you, Father. He made you a worship to the Father. Yes. You are starting from the Holy of Holies. You are there by the blood of Jesus. When you wake up, when you go to sleep, you belong in the Holy of Holies. I want to do. Worship you, Father. For you are my righteousness. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like we worship you, Father. We worship you, Father. We worship you, yes.
I worship you.
Yes. I see the Holy Spirit is here to minister to you. Let Him minister to you. Take the burdens, take the cares, take the memories. It's just you and the Father now. Let the Holy Spirit minister His life into you now. Welcome, Holy Spirit. We worship you, Father. Worship you, Father.
You are my righteousness.
No other identities can separate us. No other definitions can separate us from you. No other past experience and people's opinions can separate us from you. You call us sons. We love you, Father. Let's just have a time right now. He wants us to just worship Him and just start worship Him in tongues and words, English, Romanian, any language that you have. Just let's start worshiping the Father. We worship you, Father. We worship you. Ala sehe namrato tesu. Ala rasehe namrata suna. Glorious, glorious. Nalabrato suhana. We worship you. We worship you. Nalabrasia hamat. Olehesi abrota ke abas. Trehamana suhare. Treha. Blessed be the one. Blessed be the one. Worship, worship. Irasia baraj. O guti hela marale te seabaku. Ade seabaku trus. Jobari seabaku tine blas. My blood is sufficient. My blood is sufficient. We worship you, Jesus. We worship the Lamb of God. We worship your Abelos. O kumatleha siabrete siabuku. Peribris abatelas. New worship. New worship. From a new mind. Iasaritis. Jebrela soabas. Udirira sabadas. Yes, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Te amo, cubralas. As you say this to the Lord, you have to hear Him saying back to you, He loves you.
A
song will rise. I love you, I love you, I love you. I love you, I love you, I love you. I love you, I love you, I love you.
And my heart will follow.
We love you, Father. We love you, Jesus. As He is, so are you on this earth. As He is.
And bow down.
Yes.
Name over all names, I sing your praises. All I can say to you is, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you,
and my heart will follow.
I love you, Father.
I love you, I love you.
Because you first loved me. Oh, wow, what a joy. What a joy to enter the perfect love of my Father. What a glorious, glorious, wondrous relationship with you. I love you. I love you, my sons. I love you. You are born of me. All I have, you have. All my plans, the destiny, are for you, my sons. Oh, yes, I love you, my sons. As I love my Jesus, I love my son. I love you, my sons. And Jesus,
I follow you, I worship you, I love you.
Thank you, Father.
The lover of my soul, I love you, I follow you,
oh, my
I worship you.
My plans,
the lover
made out of love, made out of my goodness, my plans for your life, to give you the future and a hope. I have great plans for you, and no one can stop me to do that. Worship you.
Thank you.
We are in the midst. Right there, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In the midst. Oh, thank you, Father.
I adore you. May my life be for you. How I love you.
Holy Spirit,
I adore.
I love you, Jesus.
I love you, I love you, I love you.
I love you, I love you, I love you.
And my heart will follow.
Father, for songs of love. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated. Wow. I love to love him. That's the best thing. When I'm thinking what's gonna be in heaven, I'm just thinking that's just gonna flow in love. When that eternity is over, then another eternity is gonna start, and it's gonna be eternities of eternities. So, wow. It's interesting. We have these things here that we don't talk too much about. But this is our purpose. The twofold purposes is to manifest, to destroy the works of the devil and bring many souls to salvation and sons into glory. So the twofold missions that we have, and that's why we're here, that's why we broadcast, that's why we minister, because we know there are lots of works that the enemy built for 2,000 years around Christian religions everywhere around, and those things are coming down because the relationship with the Lord surpasses all of that. And then bringing many souls to salvation. And if God is speaking to them directly, hey, you're not just coming as a sinner and stay as a sinner. You are my son. I want to show you your inheritance. Enter in it right now, right? And that's sons coming into glory. Also, we are one in Christ, and that unity is now and will be continually increased throughout the world. And you that are listening to us, I was kind of blown away that people in India have more views than the people in U.S. For the English service. So that's pretty cool. So we absolutely love you in Africa and Brazil and everywhere that you are. Absolutely love you. We are foreordained to these great outer works, both at home and overseas. It is our blessing to be faithful to those we send out and those already out. So in a couple of weeks here, we're going to have kind of a retrospect. We want to call it the fruit of 2015 and kind of want to go through what happened. Maybe we can bring some of the mission trips we've been on and people that have been on the mission trips and some fruit that we've seen from there, and just bring a tithe of this amazing increase of the Father. It's so amazing. So we've been talking for the last couple of months in the morning service afternoon about fivefold ministry, and when Jesus, you know, he was raised up above all things so he can fill all things. And sometimes we like to stay at that place that's so above that nothing really touches us. We don't even think of the things down here. But he did think of the practical and down-to-earth things. So because he did think about that, he said, I'm going to send you these gifts, the apostles, the prophets, the teachers, I'm going to send you these gifts to make it practical for you. So you can walk in all my words and grow into the head, right? So this is his love, practical love. And believe me, it's a blessing to have someone in your life that you can really receive from. That's flesh and blood, but not just flesh and blood. I mean, on the inside is the son, but it's really on the outside. It's just a normal human being that you see. It's such a blessing to have that. For years, when I started my walk with him, pretty radical, I have to admit, in Romania, I was begging him to send me something, somebody that I can talk to that at least speaks the same language. And, you know, he was smiling, and he wanted me to learn straight from him. He had the reason. Now I see why he wanted that. But it's such an amazing blessing to at least bounce ideas. Or you go into a crisis, you know, who do you text first? Who do you call at 3 o'clock in the morning? It's like, this is bad, man. Can you pray with me? This is amazing. It's part of the dynamics of the body of Christ that's on this earth, right? This is great. And unfortunately, you know, the Christian religion built this type of jobs, I would say, that are so irrelevant, and they're just kind of filling some pulpits once a week or twice a week. But most of them are inaccessible. Don't support anything and don't help anything except maybe strategy, vision, some, you know, how do you get more people in the church? Yeah, but it's like, what about the broken person that's right there? So I'm talking about reality. I'm talking about you and I, as the Lord is using us through this type of ministries. Internally, we are not prophets. Inside, we are sons. We are born of him. We're a new creation. Okay? But when you start doing the work, that work is evangelistic. Because you just go and grab somebody right from the dirt, right? You tell the prodigal son, hey, what are you doing here? Your dad is waiting home for you. That's evangelist. Okay? So all this work, when you start doing this, You know, you sound like a teacher, like a pastor, like an apostle, okay? And we talked last Sunday about the way you feed yourself, the tree of knowledge, the tree of life, because lots of this doing stuff has to have the right source. And last Sunday, we talked more about the wrong tree. We talked about the tree of knowledge, because you get into yourself things from the sin consciousness. That's all you're going to teach. That's all you're going to talk to people about. Now, it's, you know, I remember a while ago, you know, when you start learning about grace and law, you know, it's, I remember I had some people had so amazing revelations of grace, but at their home was law. I said, oh, hold on, something is not right. You enjoy the grace, but you put law with your wife and the kids. That's something that's not cutting, right? No, it's grace and grace. Otherwise, it's just theoretical. It's just intellectual grace. You never got it, really. Okay? If you receive grace, you give grace. Okay? Otherwise, it's, you know, you're just imagining that you have anything. Okay? So, at the moment when the apostles, prophets, evangelists, they feed from the tree of life, this is what they are going to do. And you can find yourself doing this, maybe with a little home group, maybe with your family, maybe with your friends, okay? But this is what you are doing. And apostles, they will lay foundations. So they will go in places where there is no foundation. And that can be your friend. That can be somebody in a whole family that they never had any foundation of believing in the Lord, okay? You go and lay a foundation there of believing in the Lord. That's a brand new territory, okay? Yes, they can go in Mozambique. Yes, they can go in South America. But it can start right there in the neighborhood, okay? They lay a foundation where there was no other foundation of Christ, who we are in Him, and who He is in us. This is what the apostles do. They make sure it's about Christ in you. It's not about your ministry. It's not about your knowledge. It's not about how much you read, how much you don't read. It's about, do you know where you are and who is in you? And they made that very clear. They lay a foundation that everything about what you do stems from who you are. Okay? Prophets, encourage, edify, confirm the growing of your oneness with the Lord in your soul. So if somebody's prophetically speaking to you, it's going to always encourage, it's like, do you think this is your life? Why do you stress so much? Oh, man, it's been such a terrible week and this and this. It's like, what, isn't Christ in you? So prophetically, they will always bring this obvious, right, thing and encourage you in walking with this. The evangelists, they call the prodigals back to the Father. Pastors and teachers, they teach oversight over your soul. That's interesting. So if you really are, you know, understanding this, you're not going to try to tell people what to do. You're going to give them. Okay? Not tell them, you know, you should pray more. You should do this. You should do this. You should read that. You know? You'll give them what they need. Okay, so that's where the pastors, the teachers go. They give them that life, give them that resource, so they can do it, right? Teach oversight over your soul, freedom by laying down your soul life to receive more God's life. Okay, so this is kind of where we're going with this. Okay. So we went through a couple of verses, I think, in Corinthians last time. And I just want to bring this. And then I'm going to ask a few of you to bring some words about doing the words as a son. So this is a focus. This is not how somebody does the word, but how do you do it as a son? Okay, so these are very important areas of the doing. And we brought this up a little bit last time. So 2 Corinthians 8:10. Give you my opinion this matter, for this is to your advantage, who were the first to begin a year ago, not only to do this, but also to desire or to will to do it. So this is a first step, okay? The do, people, you know, they really get excited. When the excitement wears off, it's like, I'm tired. I'm not going to do it. Let somebody else do it. Right? So that's very typical. Typical in the world, unless they pay you, that stimulates a little bit the interest, right? unless they help you somehow, give you some help, or, you know, promise some bonuses or something. Your enthusiasm is short-lived, right? This is typical in the world of the do, and the most very excited people, they don't last too long, okay? So it's unless something happens, which is from the doing, there's a change in there where you desire the motivation. Remember when it says the word of God that judges the intention of the heart? So something happened there by the word of God and penetrates deeper than kind of a intellectual, you should do that, you should do that. You know, it's good to do that, it's good to do that. It goes deeper than that and touches the intentions of the heart and motivation. Why do you do that? Why? Why do you get up every time thinking, how can I serve my family? Why? Well, it's a good thing to do, right? Why? Why do you go to work to earn money? Why? Why do you come every Sunday? Why do you open the Bible to read? Why do you pray? Why? What is the motivation of your heart? That's the intentions of the heart. The word comes deeper and breaks through. And suddenly you realize, hey, I've been just doing things. That's why I get tired. That's why I run into the no motivation zones, because it's nothing open of the willing, of the intention. I intentionally want to love the Lord and do the word. I intentionally want to praise Him and tell my soul, bless the Lord. I intentionally do not accept depression and oppression. I intentionally cast out all the cares from my mind. I intentionally do that. I want to do it. And then there is another step that we haven't talked yet. So this is kind of an interesting one. 1 Corinthians 9, 16-17. Paul talks, so, for if I preach the gospel, I have nothing to boast of, for necessity is laid upon me. Yes, woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this willingly, I have a reward. And catch this. But if against my will, I have been entrusted with the stewardship. What is the place where the word becomes one with the one that's doing? How do you get to the place where there is nothing else but that word that comes through without even thinking about? Somebody was saying that if you take a cracker and you break it, you can never glue it back together. You can try to lick it in place. You can try to glue it. It's never going to be one cracker again. It's broken. There is a place where there is no more your will. You've been willing, you've been intending to do this, you've been really going after this, and then there's a place where Paul arrived, where like, hey, if I do it willingly, it's good. I get the reward. What? The joy. I see the harvest. He doesn't have to drag me into talking to those people. And I have a joy. No, I obey today. Look, that's so much harvest. Praise the Lord. But even if not, there is no other way for me. That's the place where the Word becomes one with you. Because there is no other option. Absolutely no other option. That knowing of that prayer thing, that knowing of the sonship thing, that knowing of the faith and rejoicing thing, that's part of you. So when craziness hits, you cannot but start in rejoicing. And you might look from outside that you is like, oh my gosh, I got completely destroyed. There's no more of that left. This is absolutely a complete takeover. He took over me. This is a takeover. I don't know what's happening here. You know, I cannot but love. You know, and hate comes and hate comes. And it's like, I cannot but love. I'm not even thinking about, okay, all right, that's okay. That's, I see what's happening. So the enemy is attacking. It's these accusations. You know, what should I do? The word says love. Okay, I'm loving you. It's not even that. It's no time. Because you are becoming one of that. That's only love that can come through. This is where he got in. This is where ministry, it's not about what you do. It's about who you are. I was in India one time and I was talking to this prophet guy, really particular, very visionary, very clear, having all these prophetic words. And, you know, I was walking in prophetic at the time. And the Lord said, you know, you're not there to debate prophecy. And it's like, what should I do? It's nothing new I can tell him. I mean, it's like he really sees, right? The only thing he gave me was the time is coming when you're not going to deliver the words. You're going to be the words. Welcome to sonship. Okay, so this is a little bit different. I know it kind of went like this, you know, he continued his gifts and all this stuff, and praise the Lord, you know, he got lots of gifts. But I realized that the way he would take me and the way he does in my life is, it's so different than the fivefold ministry, because the Son was taking over. So, good. We have few of the words now, so I'm not sure if this is the next one. Does anybody has this? You got? Okay. Then you're going to start, and I can actually put the other verses. So we have few. I have like three places in the scripture of the doing, and I asked few of you to talk. If there is another word that you want to talk, I think Paul is going to talk about a couple of words. It's okay. Okay?
All right. So, the verse that we're going to look at is Ephesians 4:22-24. I'm going to read it here so I don't turn around. That you put off concerning your former conduct, the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. So who are we? As John 1:12 said, as I said this morning, to all who received and believed him, he gave the right to be sons of God, born not of blood, not of the will of the flesh, not of the will of men, but born of God. What does that mean? We're born of God. Okay, so now what? I'm still dealing with things. I'm still seeing myself sometimes as I used to be. Anger sometimes rises up. What does that mean? Does that mean that I'm not saved? Does that mean I'm not a son? So as we look at the scripture, we see doing of this word, put off. It's something we need to do. You see the anger coming, you know what it is. You know, it's a spirit of anger. You know, it's not you anymore. Now you are seated with Christ above all principalities and power. This anger has no longer control over you. It shouldn't have control over you. It shouldn't have any power over you anymore. You put it off. You don't accept it for even a second. A thought comes in. They used to, some people are just, they have all these weird thoughts that come in. I know I used to, after I had my first child, I had all these intruding thoughts that I felt like I couldn't stop. Horrible, horrible thoughts that I knew were not me, even back then. But I felt like I had no power over them to stop them because I didn't know how. I didn't know I had to put off those thoughts or bring them into captivity to his obedience. So we put off anything that we know, and he gives us the discernment. We have everything he has to be able to see what we need to put off. Like Claude was saying this morning, he's not giving us this, he's not showing us with a code, I don't know why you called it, Morse code. He's not explaining it that way for us to you know, have such a hard time discerning. He's clear. We know what the former conduct was. We have to discern to know that's not us. So we put off concerning our former conduct, the old man, which interestingly grows. If we let it, it will grow. How does it grow? Definitely not in peace, definitely not in wholeness, definitely not in health. It grows corrupt. Now this corruption can really, even for a son, if you allow the old man to come, you will find yourself drowning. You'll find yourself with all kinds of things attached to you, the enemy. It will be open doors that the enemy can just come in because of a simple fact that you did not put off the old man. Fear will be the first thing that will come in. I can guarantee it. If you don't put on the off the old man, fear will come in and everything will just go downhill from there. And then what? So you put off, and now what? Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. How do you renew yourself in the spirit of your mind? We have the Word of God. You declare the Word of God over you. You speak it every day, in every circumstance. If let's say, you know, the enemy is not very creative. Okay, he will come back with the same thing over and over again. If before you used to be fearful of the dark, let's say, and if that door has not been completely closed, he will try and come back with the same fear, with the same thing. Now, the renewing of the mind comes, no, he did not give me a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and sound mind. You declare that over you, you speak it out loud, you put off any other thought that does not come, that comes against that. And that's how your mind gets renewed. And we do that every single day. If you have to declare it 50 times a day at the beginning, you do it. There's no other way. And then, guess what? The more you do it, the less you have to do it. Because in that area, that's your soul in that area will have the overcoming. And then it will not come the same way. I remember when I used to deal with insomnia. And I thought it went away. I declared it. And then not long ago, again, it came back with the same stuff. And you know what? This time around, I didn't have to have a sleepless night. I had half a night because I said, no more. That's it. You cannot come back. You can't. So we put on the new man. We are renewed in the spirit of our mind. And the new man was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. And as you put on this new man, guess what? Not only are you walking in who you were designed to be, but the life that he put in you will be multiplied in others. The old man can never do that. The old man brings death. If you are not walking in this newness, oneness with the Lord that he intended for us to walk in, and you just, all you give is the old man, people will not have what to receive. He won't be drawn to that. They won't want the life. What life? The fear and the doubt and the worry and the anxiety. Nobody wants that. So let's all just put off the old man, be renewed in the spirit of our mind, and put on the new man. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Very good. Anybody else has this verse? If not, yeah, go ahead.
It is so important to put off. If you don't do it, it will not happen. The new thing is not another way. Is no way. Is no way. The old man grows. Remember the principle of the seed? The good seed and the bad seed, they grow together till the harvest is coming, and the good one will always stand. But they grow. They grow. So it is a corruption, and the corruption is coming from our mind. Is that coming through? It's coming from our thought, how we are thinking. It is so big trouble right now in this world with everything what is going on, because everything what we hear is watch out, be ready, be prepared. Did you do that? Did you do that? Did you buy that? Did you... What are you doing? You don't do anything? Did you see what happened there? Yes, I do. I am in this world. But my mind system overcome the world. Because it's not a corrupting mind. It's not based on what I see. It's based on what God said, I am for you and not against you. Thousands will come against you. They will fall. I will lift you up. I am your God. I never changed. So, if I don't turn off what the world system, my own system can say, I will never can benefit of what God said. You have to finish like he did, finished, to begin a new life. He finished on the cross, the old man. Everything what was corrupted, he put to death. Everything was turned off for the new man and the new life to come. Was not another way. So I want to tell you, it's not optional. It is no option. You don't have a... People talk about free will. Free will to turn off or to keep on. Yes. But if you want to be on the new life, you have to turn off the old one. The new man is created according to God. You see, the beginning is according to the deceitful lust. And this one according to God. Which one you choose? You have to turn off something for something else to be turned on. In true righteousness and holiness. So you can have righteousness and holiness, or you can have deceitful lust. Which one you choose? Which one you turn off? I remember it's a verse in the Bible, I think in Luke, what is talking about the perversion generation, perverted generation. That is connected with the perverted mind. The perverted thought, thinking, Everything what is not what God said is perverted. Was for me absolutely everything what is not according to God's word is perverted. It is very scary, but very true. So you have to know everything what you is looking good, makes sense, and is not what God said, the perverted thought. Wow. The word of God is like a sword, sharp, to separate it, the spirit and the soul. It is so important. Turn off the old man and walk in the new man. God bless you.
Next word. Yeah. Okay. Oh, she's. Thank you.
Hello. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. Therefore, you shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. I was thinking how this very verse has absolutely changed the whole Christianity. Without this verse, Christianity would have been same religion, just like they have out there. But the fact that we turn bad with good, we love our enemies, we bless those who curse us, we do good to those who hate you, to those who hate us, this is a game changer in the whole Christianity. And this makes God so amazing. He is absolutely amazing. There are almost like no words to, it's almost thinking like, how can somebody say that? It's that outrageous. I remember my college years. I actually went to a Christian high school. So I lived a good life. Nobody persecuted me. It was nice and easy. But then when I went to high school, when I went to college, all of a sudden I'm in between all these non-Christian people. And it was such a struggle because I remember, in a way, I wanted to fit in. But since I was the only one, I knew that I will never fit in. I was not like them. And I was constantly almost like battling myself to say, can I just put what I am aside for a second and be like them so I can fit in? And every time I left my classes, I thought, no, I cannot give up what I am. For what? To be like them? And they were constantly persecuting me and just mocking me. And they knew I was already working at a church, and they found every little thing to just throw it at me, and I guess to cause me sadness. And at the time, I was really strong in my faith, and I had like little moments of doubt, but then I was like, no, my faith is the thing that has kept me going for such a long time. It's not worth it. And I loved them. It was hard. But I stayed there and I tried my hardest at the time, that's what I knew, to love them, and I blessed them. And I remember one day in class, they scheduled an exam on Sunday, and everybody agreed, like, oh yeah, Sunday is great, we can do a Sunday. And I was the only person to say, no, I go to church and I cannot do it. So everybody had to reschedule just because of me, and they were so mad. here's this Christian that ruins everything. So just for the fact that I stood up and I said, no, you know, I'd rather miss this exam than miss my church. There I was standing like a flower in between all these bushes that tried to cover me. And it was just such a moment, like I realized nothing. Whatever they try to do against me, they cannot do it because I am the light of the world. So love is the ultimate thing. Love is just amazing. Love will break every darkness, every curse. Love can do so much. I was telling my husband's, my boss's husband, that Tuesday is my last day, and he was so sad. Well, he is this guy that never shows any emotion, like ever. He doesn't smile, he doesn't laugh, he doesn't show he's sad. He's just so serious all the time, and it's hard to make him smile or it's hard to make him laugh. Well, I told him, hey, you know, Tuesday is my last day. And I said, I hope you find somebody that, I don't know, you like, and that a nice girl that can work here and does a good job. And he said, which it's interesting because since he doesn't show any emotion, he said, well, I'm sad that you're leaving. I don't think we will ever find someone like you. And I was like, great. They're not Christians. And I remember my first day working with him. I said hi in English. And he's like, what are you? Are you American? Why would you say hi? You're supposed to speak in Romanian. And I was like, great, first day. So he just gave me a hard start. But I chose to love and bless them and do so much good. And here he is after 2 years saying, we will never find someone like you. So love ultimately conquers everything. Amen.
Amen. Yeah, I have the same verse, Matthew 5:44. Love, I guess she hit pretty much everything what the power of love does. When we demonstrate and show love, it breaks the chains and the captivity that the person is held in bondage to when we demonstrate the love, because love can only break the feelings and emotion that the other person brings against you. When somebody comes to you with affliction to hurt you, to bring you down, the only reason a lot of the times they're doing it is because of something that they've been hurt with or been pressed into to get them to feel and that emotion into their soul. So what they learned to do in return was to just speak out of their soul to cover up the way they're feeling. They push it onto you so they could feel better about themselves in that moment. And the Lord is teaching us here to love them, to look past that. Do not look at them according to the flesh. He wants us to look at them according to who they are in the spirit and who he created them to be, because it is the human nature that is corrupt, you know. And he wants us to learn to not work according to the way in the old man, I guess, because in the old man it is very easily you are guided and by your emotions and by your feelings and all of this, you know, that person, like we talked earlier, the list comes out. Somebody comes in, you have a friend, and you try to forgive them. You forgive them for their affliction, whatever they said to you, you forgive them. But then that same person comes again to you and causes that emotion to rise up within you again. You just pull out the list again. Oh, not again. And you just add another one to the list. So it was never really surrendered to the Lord. You just you know, you just kind of put it in your back pocket, is how it was mentioned. It was a very nice illustration of what we do in human nature. And how it said earlier in Ephesians 4:22 was that to put off that old man. If you mean you literally have to choose to put off that old man and walk according to the mind of the Spirit. When you start realizing that there is your spirit before the flesh, then it is easy to walk according to God, according to who He really is, and who He is love, and all that He has to give is love. I mean, He is love, and He has to give love. Therefore, like it says in Matthew 5:44, therefore you shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. How is He perfect? He's perfect in love. I mean, love, He is love. He is the whole everything. And we are learning to put off everything that's according to human nature and human upbringing. Put that off and choose to walk in obedience and in love. Therefore, when someone comes to you to hurt you, know that it is just the target of the enemy to try to bring you to this place where you are in your soul, in yourself, you know. There, and if you get to that place, you cannot walk according to the Spirit because you are so thoughtful about who you are. Well, Christ says you are dead. It is no longer you that lives, but it is I who live in you. Galatians 2:20. So when you are consciously aware that you are, that is Christ in you, therefore the fruits of that, the fruits that He wants you to live out is love. And a lot of times our soul is, I mean, not a lot, it is. Our soul is getting worked on each and every day, which surprises us, that literally takes us out of us, and we start to see that, wow, the Lord really is changing and transforming us from day to day. He brings us from glory to glory, from glory to glory. He's constantly doing it. But what we choose to do is put off the old man. I mean, that's our choice. When we know that we are not that person, we are not the anger that rises up within us, you choose to release forgiveness and love, it totally changes the outcome, and it changes the atmosphere. If you're a positive person in a negative room, the atmosphere in that room will change just because they see the positivity coming from you. It radiates louder. So the light and the darkness casts out darkness. It changes everything. So how we live our life according to every day, you know, if we just demonstrate that love, we have nothing to reap back but the love. And God is love. So, amen to that.
So, you know, in the Christian religion, the whole religious system, the way it works, they have these pastors and teachers, and it looks like they are doing the whole job, pretty much. The people listening, they are just sucking stuff from them, but this board of ministry, the teachers, they are doing the whole job. They are teaching them stuff, but they don't get them to do the stuff. What I'm saying is like this palm. If the board of ministry is this part of the palm, and they don't get all the fingers to work, you cannot get things with only this part without moving your fingers. Like you're trying to grab this up or to grab my cell phone. You can't do it. You need to use the whole palm. Now, we are the body of Christ. We all are full of life. We are all one body. We are all, it's Christ who lives through us. It's not through the board of ministry. Not only through them, through every single member of the body. So this is why we are talking, let's bring the truth on the ground. Let's bring it in practical doing. We are spirit, Spirit born of him. He's the father of lights. We are the light of the world, like Jesus is the light of the world. We are born of him. We have his seed in us. From that perspective looking at our soul, which is here in these bodies. So our soul has will, mind, emotions. And I like what Paul said at one point. He said, you need to talk to the soul like he's a child. You commend the soul what to do. Because all of a sudden, someone tells you, I don't know what, and you get so mad. You commend that soul. Hey, be quiet. I'm not mad. I'm born of love. I'm born of the word. You do these things. You don't rule over what's happening in you. You rule over your own soul. That's why I say you work the garden. The garden itself cannot unpluck trees and weeds out of it. It's you. You work the garden. So, that being said, we get to this verse, Matthew 5:44. I'm going to read 44. No. This is something wrong right here. Okay. 2 Peter 1, 3. Right there, you see 3 and 5. I'm going to read the 4 as well. So his divine power has granted us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. So what he's saying, he gave you everything, absolutely everything. Now, if I am really hungry and I have $2,000 in my pocket, if I don't know it, it's like I don't have the money. I'm begging for food. I'm desperate. My stomach is hurting. My head is headache and stuff. But if I know I have the money, I don't have to struggle. I don't have to ask anyone. I can buy food from anywhere, whatever I want. I can eat that. I can get really full. So his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. So we got the money in the pocket. Through the knowledge. Oh, so if we know it, then we have it. If you don't know, it's like you don't have it. Through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. Verse 4, which is not there, he says, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises. So this is practical, the money. So that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sin and desire. So he gave us something practical, his promises. Verse 5, for this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, virtue with virtue, and virtue with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with steadfastness, and steadfastness with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love. So it says, verse 5, for this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with. So now he gave me the promise. And now I know, I got the promises, I got the money. Go buy food. This is what he's saying. Go buy food. Now, like I said in the morning, every time I drank a cup of coffee, really strong coffee, I would get a headache. Like, for maybe half an hour, then it would be gone. So because it happened to me so many times, this week, I just drank one, because I kill it right away. I don't wait to. And it started to happen, every single time. And I said, no. Because the devil is, let me in, because you have an excuse now. It happened to you every single time. But this time, I heard it differently, actually. Because he was not like, give me an excuse. He was like, it's natural. It is natural, that to hurt. But I heard it through the Holy Spirit. He's like, give me an excuse to stay longer. I said, no, not anymore. You get out right now. You have no place in me. It was gone right on the spot. I buy food. I have the promise that nothing by any means can touch me. If it tries, I use the money. No, you have no place in here. Get out right now. And this is what it says. For this very reason, make every effort. We can do this. We cannot give up. We are in him. We are born of him. Let's kill that. Destroy the works of the devil. That's what we do. We are sons.
That is what we do. And it's fun. Well, you know, if he has fun torturing us, why can't we have fun destroying him, you know? Amen? Amen. Exactly. It's the biggest loser that ever existed. Was born to lose. So we were talking about doing the word and discipling the soul and how the word works and what the word produces, and we have the promises and we have all these things. And there have been some times in my life that I'll get deceived, or I'll just be foolish, or I won't pay attention, and something would sneak in, or I would get attacked, or I would, you know, be deceived into allowing Lord knows what to come in. And then it's almost like you find yourself in a position or in a place where you're already under it, and then you gotta try to do the word to get out of it. You know what I'm saying? So it's flu season, but we know that that has no place in us. It's good for us, And then you wake up in the morning, you open your eyes, you get up, and bam, your nose is stuffed. You are as sick as a dog. How the heck did this get in here? You don't even remember. You don't even know. Was it fear? Was it whatever? It really doesn't matter, because now you're sick. And so now you have to lay hold of the word and of the promise that by his stripes I'm healed, right? This is what we learned to do. And what I'd like to point out is sometimes when we do the word, or we try to do the word, it doesn't seem to work. Not that it's not the truth and not that it doesn't have power, but it's not producing fruit in our lives. And so I'd like to bring the parable of the sower. And so we have all the different grounds, and then towards the end it talks about the seed that fell amongst the thorns. And if you actually look in the Greek, it says that it actually fell, that seed fell among the seed of the thorns. They weren't already full-blown thorns. And it says that the worries of the world choked out the seed. Not that it killed it, not that it destroyed it, but it slowly choked it out as it began to grow. Because as that seed began to grow, the thorns began to grow also, surrounding it and entangling it, and slowly just surrounding it and choking it off so that it could not produce the fruit. And so we find ourselves in that place in the morning. You wake up and you're like, oh man, I'm sick. And immediately, oh, how am I going to go to work? I'm so sick. And so all these worries start to kind of creep in and kind of just start to surround you. And they kind of, oh, you got to go to work. You got to take the kids. You got to do this. You got to do that. Oh, and you're sick. And so you start freaking out because of the worries. And then you try to do the word. And the word is true. And the word is alive. But because of those worries that are now surrounding you, as you try to do the word, those worries just seem to kind of multiply, and they begin to choke it out. Because those worries actually come and they start hindering the faith that you're mixing with the word so that it can be alive. And so worries, if we actually look at them, not only are they complete lies, but underlined, deep down in the worry is fear and doubt. And that's what hinders the faith. And so those fears and doubts are what's actually kind of fueling you to do the word, and it's not really working. And so 1 Peter 5:7, it says, cast all your cares upon the Lord. So when you find yourself in a position where all these burdens and these worries are starting to pile on to try to hinder you from partaking of the precious promises, of getting that deliverance, of being healed, we have all these amazing words. Take those casts, take those burdens, and you cast them on the Lord. You know what? No. You got to deal with the worries first before you start. You got to get rid of the fear before you start doing the word. You can't do the word because you're afraid. It doesn't work like that. And so we find ourselves sometimes under this spasm attacks.
You tell me nothing but all the problems I've got. Thank you. Hallelujah. We have no place.
Okay. Good correction. Very difficult. Okay. As you're ministering out there, you give the people what they need. You tell them all day long about what their problem are and all that you put into them. We are to minister the word of God, not the word of the devil or the problems of the world. I got more images in my mind about being sick and having problems in the last 10 minutes than I've got about how powerful the word is to cause me to overcome. Now let's look at love, because that's what we've been talking about. Our Lord is love. I love Paul with all my heart. Lay my life down for him. Take him anywhere in the world with me. I love you. Jesus loves me. But he has no place with me. None. To walk in disobedience, to walk in unbelief, to walk in fear, to walk in ministry that's not him. It says, if anyone speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. The enemy will come against you and say, well, you're not kind. The enemy will say, well, you're not sweet. Well, you're not this, and you're not that, and you're not this. Because the enemy is a liar. And Jesus is the truth. And you know that the truth stands alone as the light of what it is. It is no respecter of persons. It is no respecter of flesh. It is no respecter of the man's humanistic world. The Word of God does not. Jesus loves you enough to die for you that you can have a new life. You can't keep your old life. You can't keep the old unbelief, doubt. You can't keep the old hardness that is of the flesh. But you will take on his life. And this is very important. Very important, because right now in our world, Babylon is pushing and pressing upon the body of Christ, and it is called confusion. In talking with those that were afflicted and hurt, he didn't tell them how afflicted they were and how they were going to be. He gave them hope in him, in him, in him, to be healed in him, knowing they were going to get sick again. But to those of us that are now in him, it's about being a whole, complete, new creature. Not part old creature and new creature. Not part light and dark, but a complete new creature. Here is the absolute freedom. Absolute freedom, the new creature. So let's think about love. I am not rude. How does that work? I am not rude. It says in love, love is not rude. How is Jesus not rude when he is rebuking the Pharisee that he is casting down their words and telling them that they're liars and snakes? How is he not rude? From whose position of observation is he not rude? Obviously, it wasn't from the Pharisees, but it was from his father's. Not boastful. From what position was Jesus not boastful? Come unto me and eat, and come unto me and drink, and you will have life. Oh, who does he think he is, the Son of God? From whose position was he not boastful? From his father's. What I'm getting at is that the love of man needs to pass away, that you can have the love of God. His perfect love casts out all fear. Every word of sickness, disease, and the curse has no place. No place in you. No place in you. No place in you because you've already overcome it. Now, there's a way to be discipled. And to be discipled, we do not exalt the curse. Don't exalt the curse in your own mind. You have a symptom, cast it out. You don't exalt the system. You don't try to figure out how the system got, symptom came to you, all of the situation. Do not get into that realm, but stand in the power of God. It is the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel, the good news of Jesus, is the power of God. Not the knowledge about sin. That's not the power of God. Not the knowledge about the carnal man. That's not the power of God. We are doers of the word. Now, back, and then mentioned this in the first service. Back in 1941, there was propaganda that came out into the world. Propaganda. Now, we call it advertising today. But back then, they just called it propaganda. And it said very simply, the voice of it was, be tolerant with me. Be tolerant with me. And it was evil speaking. Evil said, be tolerant with me. And so, the word tolerant, all of a sudden, had no longer any power of judgment from God against evil. And you see that today. Oh, I love you so much. Don't judge me. What are you trying to judge me? You don't have to judge any person on this planet. You don't have to judge any man, any woman, any leader. You don't have to judge them, but you have to judge the evil because your Father is in you to judge the evil. And there's nothing that you can do except hate it. How can love hate? Because God hates evil. He multiplies back to evil what evil gave to him. You have to hate evil. You don't hate the people. Be gentle as you can. Be kind as you can. Be sweet as you can. Love people as much as you can, but you cannot love their state of death. You cannot love their state of existence. You cannot love the fact that they may go to hell. You cannot love the fact that they're under some kind of situation that is constantly keeping them under the curse. You cannot love the evil. The Old Testament prophets came up because the false teachers and the false prophets were shepherding Israel, and the Israel was beat down and broken and in poverty and distracted away from God, and the prophets had to speak the word to rebuke it. And it wasn't happy, and it wasn't nice. It doesn't sound good to my soul, you know, for someone tell me that I'm doing something wrong. Doesn't sound good to me. I don't like the feelings of it. But if it's God and it's righteous judgment, I'm going to get out of the way. Because anything in us that is not coming from resurrection life from that cross has no right to be there. And if we learn in some way and we have to totally repent in the way that we learned and learn a whole nother way of how to walk as the light of the world. Everybody wants to apologize to everybody for existing. You have nothing to apologize to anybody for if you're a son of God. Don't apologize to those people because you're sorry that they've got a problem. Don't apologize to them. The world is in a big hurt, and the only truth and the only reality is not your good feelings. It's the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I began to minister. I began to minister, and I began to share, bringing in power to the name of Jesus Christ around the world. During this season, I'm so excited about the fact that the name Jesus Christ is exalted everywhere in the world. Everybody speaks it, not in a bad term. However they're saying it, it's kind of like there's a little baby in Bethlehem, whatever. So I began to intercede and release the power of God to go out to bring increase to everybody that speaks that name in all of these countries. I remember last year traveling through Kuala Lumpur and through Southeast Asia. The airlines all had these Christmas songs in the airports in English. Jesus, 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 Jesus. And half the people have no idea who Jesus is. The power of the name of Jesus. Do you think that God is joking about the judgment? No, he's not. Is he just sitting back and being gentle and kind toward all of those that hate his son continually? No, he's not. He never has. It's never been that way. You are the righteousness of God. Do you think he's just sitting back for those that have persecuted you? No, there is not a chance. He will surely bring recompense to you for anyone that's come against you. All right, so in this, we have the fact that we're learning to do the will of God. Now, I step out, and I know that I step out, and I'm an example to extreme attitudes about Jesus. I know I'm an example to that. And some people, they might get a little upset with some of my extreme ways of presenting the word. That's okay. I've lived with that for 50 years, and I'll continue to go on. Because if I get one person that listens to me that lays hold of that kind of power, it will change their lives, and they will never walk under the curse again. And I tell you, I've dealt with people for 25 and 30 years, still decide to walk under the curse. And it's not for you. And it doesn't please God. And you're not being a doer of the word if you give place to the curse in your life. So, he is in you, both to will and to do his good pleasure. He's the one that's in you. It's him. It's not you. It's not about you except for what he wants to do with you in the fullness of bringing his kingdom into you. So in doing the word, you have to let him be who he is. Yes, he is love and joy and gentleness and goodness and peace. But if that's the only little parts you've got, you're going to be under the curse. You've got to have his judgment against evil and be of no respecter of persons, including yourself. There's no way you can just take the really good, sweet little lovey places that you think he is and say, that's what I'm like. No, you have to take the whole thing. You have to take the warfare and you have to take the pleasant parts. You have to take the praise and you have to take the condemnation that tries to come against you and the rejection that comes against you because you are him, because that's him in you. And so that word, the word of doing, is this. Now has come. Now has come salvation and strength to you. Now has come salvation and strength to you. By the word of your testimony, by the blood of the Lamb, and you love not your self-life all the way unto death. This is the overcoming that the book of Revelations says we can all come into. But you have to be really serious sometimes about your attitudes and your emotions and your will and your mind and what you're doing and what you're saying to people. You have to be serious with yourself. If I tell you anything less than I did today, I would be in sin. If you were hurt by what I said, or you felt bad by the way that I presented it, I can't help that. But I would be in sin if I didn't give you what was on my heart from the Lord. Because I know it's right. Now, I want you to pray with me. I want us to pray what I said before, that the power, you are seated with Christ on the throne, that the power of the name of our King, the power of that name, which has been so slurred and so cast down and so belittled by the world, that the Father would, through us, increase the power of that name, the very name, Jesus Christ, be exalted over all the earth. During this season right now where it goes out everywhere. You ready? Let's pray together, all of us out here. Father, we just come before you right now. We thank you right now. We thank you that we are overcome. We have overcome all of the curse. And we're seated next to you. We are in you, Lord Jesus. And we release power and authority to the name that is above every name. That as that name is expressed in the earth, that name bring fear to the devils, that name bring healing to the lost, salvation to their souls, that name be exalted in power upon the earth. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So, thank you for bearing with me. Sometimes I don't know how you can bring the word out like that and try to bring it out through some form of gentleness, because the word cuts. And I'm not just speaking to you, but through you. He wants to manifest himself in us, and he's not going to stop from anything left. You don't hear from me, you're going to hear from somebody else. You don't hear from somebody else, you're going to hear it directly in your own heart. You're going to be on your knees weeping under the pain, because he's not going to allow anything but himself to live in his body. This is absolute. So, praise the Lord, you guys. This is a wonderful time. Continue with the intercession, releasing the power of the name of Jesus into everybody who speaks his name. even if they don't believe in him, let the name have the power. That's what I saw in the first church. You can go back and look in the Word. That's what we see in the first. The name had the power. Amen. All right. God bless you. We'll see you next week.